Welcome to the Middle Earth panel. My name is Cindy Keeler. I'm a writer with theonering.net. And on behalf of the Cincinnati Comic Expo, it is my great pleasure to welcome Mr. Graham McTavish and Mr. Sean Astin.
My people, your people.
It is great to have you. Great to have you with us. All a bunch of Lord of the Rings fans and many other fandoms here. We spoke a little last night about how when you were getting ready to do The Hobbit, you kind of knew from before what you might be getting into. But Sean, when they started with The Lord of the Rings, you guys really just had no idea. Did you?
You knew it would be big. You know, you get down there and you see just going through the Weta workshop and the total number of orc rubber costumes, you just kept walking and walking and they just kept coming. And, you know, and there's a sword guy who's, you know, forging swords, you know, with an anvil and a thing. And there's the chainmail guy. The chainmail guy. I remember we were shooting at Mount Ruapehu, and it was one of the days the New Zealand Army came out, and they were all dressed as orcs, and that was fun for them. That was better than a day's work, and they're, you know, there's a lot of people. So I'm sitting there eating up on the it's a ski resort, really. So I was on the balcony or whatever with the ski resort with my little plate of lamb. It's all you can basically eat in New Zealand. right? And fish. You can get fish, too. Lamb and fish, yeah. And other crazy vegetables you never heard of. But I'm sitting next to this guy, this older guy, who's kind of got gnarled hands, and he just looks kind of like either bohemian or homeless. You don't know. So I'm pretty clear because of the hobbit ears and the hair and the feet and the, like, it's pretty clear. You know, I'm not undercover. So I start talking to him, and, you know, what do you do? And he says, oh, I work on the chainmail. What do you mean? He said, "Well, I make the chainmail for all the costumes." What do you mean? You make it? He said, "Yeah." I said, "So like you set up the machine?" And he goes, "No, we do it all by hand. I do it by hand." And he had in his pocket a couple of pieces of the links of the chainmail, and he showed me how with this pliers he would clamp it together, and it was hard. It was hard to do it. And so clamp one thing down, and then, you know, and then you got to get the other piece and blah, 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 and it takes more time and blah, 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 clamp like that. And, you know, and after just a few minutes of describing it to me, he had only in the description gotten through three pieces of chain link. And I said, well, how long have you been working on it? He said about 7 years. And we looked up and you could see, kind of like the Jet Propulsion Lab when they send like the Mars rover or something and they have to wait years for it to get there. And then they have about 3 minutes to see if it makes it through the atmosphere and either all their work is for naught or they succeed. It was like that. He was looking out and like the 700 people, all of his chainmail was walking around all the late nights of clamping it down. So, you know, you knew it was going to be big, but we definitely, I would like to think that some of the prosthetic stuff, some of the just the way they constructed the sets was more efficient because there was a lot of stuff that we would end up redoing as we got there. And like by the end of it and during the pickups, the reshoots or whatever, we'd go back and just get, you know, the 3 minutes that they need for that sequence. Well, and it only took 15 days, whereas on the movie it would have taken 40 days or something like that, you know, so they learned a lot. I don't know.
Well, yeah. I mean, it was what I was surprised about, though, was the sort of ruthlessness of what Peter would do sometimes in terms if it wasn't exactly what he wanted. So a lot of work, you know, months of work, could just be got rid of like that. I remember particularly when we were doing the goblins. They originally had them as animatronic heads so that they had servers inside them and people operated them remote control. People wore them. There were the whole goblin suits, which were the equivalent of wearing, I think, about four wetsuits at the same time. People were passing out. The guy in front of me just collapsed and all this sort of thing. And Peter came on set early on, and they were very proud of these wonderful things. And they were absolutely amazing. And he just looked at them and said, no, no, it's not going to work. So we need to do something different. And you could see the faces are just like, oh, God. But credit to them, they went off and they did it. And that was the extraordinary thing, that you could get a set or a set of costumes or a weapon, and if it wasn't what he wanted, he wasn't shy of saying so, and they would go back. And so these people were working, you know, like with just the prosthetics, they were working 24 hours a day. They were running those prosthetics 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for 2.5 years, pretty much, constantly creating them. Yeah.
I've done several movies in New Zealand. And the first one, I was 15 or 16. We went down to shoot some whitewater rapids sequences for this little Kevin Bacon whitewater rafting movie that we did, the one without Meryl Streep. And the thing that characterized the New Zealand experience for me was the ingenuity, that there was just nothing they wouldn't try. You know, they were very clever. They would do this and they would do that, and if it didn't work, and it didn't matter where the good idea came from. I remember one day we were doing a scene where some characters, it might have been in the hall that we go running down before we get to the Bridge of Khazad-dûm. I can't remember what that hall is, but anyhow, the cave, it's in the caves, the dwarf caves. So they had set up, and this is sort of the thing in Hollywood. It used to be, before digital came in and before all the great new pieces of technology, you know, Steven Spielberg did an 80-foot dolly track in color purple, and that was in town. That was a kind of, for a period of time, sort of a record that people would note. And this director, and because it takes a long time to set it up, it takes forever to shoot it, it's expensive, you know, and there's other ways to accomplish it, and it's a little bit, you know, a lot of times it can be self-indulgent to do that. Well, Peter was taking his place in that, you know, chain, and so he had set up this long dolly track, and the way the dolly works is you have two handles, one on either side of the back of the dolly, and the dolly grip, you know, pushes, and there's the track has little connectors that connect both sides of the rails together. So to run down with that, there's a risk that you'll trip when you're running on the middle. So they would get guys on either side and hold the, you know, the, not that much wider, maybe, you know, 8 inches wide, those little things, and they would start running with it. And they wanted it to go faster and faster and faster. And then they've got to be able to, you know, you have to have a certain amount of track to slow down. And you can, your hands, these guys' hands are sweaty. You know, the dolly is really heavy. So I remember at one point I said, you know, I have an idea. And people looked at me. I said, why don't you put a bar across and, you know, tie it down on those things, and then you can kind of stand and run with it. And the grip looked at me and he went, huh. That's a pretty good idea. So they put it there, and they did so many takes on everything. They probably did 20 takes on it. And every time these big guys, now with their tennis shoes on instead of their boots, would go running down like bobsledders at the beginning of the bobsledding thing, I would just sit there like, oh, that was my idea.
Good for you. That's great.
Yeah. We had talked just a little, cut the tip of the iceberg on the Middle Earth thing about how when Peter Jackson took these beloved books, especially with The Hobbit, how he sort of adulted it up a little bit to kind of make it more consistent. The book started out as sort of comedy, we're light, we're hobbits, and then later it's I am the king under the mountain. That sort of led, and didn't it, to your big scene there at the end with Thorin when...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, well, yes, he was very keen to, because The Hobbit being essentially more of a children's book than The Lord of the Rings. When I read The Lord of the Rings, I was 18, and I'd never read The Hobbit, and I didn't read The Hobbit after The Lord of the Rings because I thought, well, that's a kid's book, so why would I be reading it when I was 18? But what Peter did was expand that book, as you know, to three movies, using these appendices that Tolkien subsequently wrote, because Tolkien himself was aware that The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings, because there was quite a big gap between the writing of them, that world had changed in his mind, so that he wanted to bridge those worlds and wrote the appendices accordingly. And that's what Peter drew on to add substance to the three movies. But the adult content, yeah, with the whole relationship with Thorin, it is. I mean, that's why I do find it interesting the slow deterioration of the dwarves' relationships as the journey goes on. That they all start and there's a lot of humor and everything's kind of funny and they're throwing food at each other, and by the end, you know, they're mutinous and wanted to kill each other in some cases. So yeah, that was part of the journey that we all went on. Fortunately, as actors, we didn't get to that point where we were wanting to kill each other. You know, there were a couple of days that it got a little close with some people, but, you know, we got through it. But it was, yeah, it was... Oh, no. You're not getting that out of me. But, yeah, we went on a journey just like the characters went on a journey throughout the film. So by the end of it, we were a little different to when we began. Yeah.
I feel like my favorite part of the first one was the singing and throwing the plate stuff. Because it was that whimsy is what touched me, and it was like he didn't abandon it. And the Middle Earth thematic, you know, just the whole aesthetic of them. It's meant to be a six, you know, and someone's going to do the Silmarillion, right? Somebody's got to try and put that one on. But you see it? That woo represents $1 billion, so the studio will figure out how to do it. But I mean,
Warner Brothers,
yeah. But all of a sudden in the story, oh, I had that same feeling I had when I was it tapped into something from my childhood, and I have kids, so I think, you know, when you read to them, you want to find some gateway into their imagination and have that experience. So that's. So I like that.
And I think as well that there is something essentially childlike about the dwarves to a lot of extent. I think that's part of their appeal to a lot of people, is that they represent something childlike to an audience. And we certainly tried to bring that out in Bag End when we were flinging food at each other for 2 weeks, trying to ram a tomato up poor Stephen Hunter's nose. I thought it was his mouth. I did. I was behind him. I was behind him. And I was trying to get a tomato in his mouth, and then I found myself accidentally ramming it up his nose. And amazingly, I mean, he's such a trooper. He never even stopped. He didn't go, "Would you stop doing that?" He carried on. So, yeah, that was Stephen for you.
And on that note, can I ask, the relationship between Frodo and Sam is quite, you know, a lot of people have written a lot of stuff about it, how it's the central... Ooh, that was a bad line.
She's asking an archetypal...
No.
You know, and the fan fiction over here is like, you know...
Yeah. The shippers among you.
Yeah, I wouldn't go in there. Don't you go there either. No. No, but
it's a very powerful love relationship. There's no question about it. Absent sexuality.
And some people have gone so far as to call Sam the hero of the story.
Well, he's certainly one of them.
Yeah.
He's certainly one of the nine.
Well, for you, having made these three long movies with long threads of character and development, do you go back now? Is there a moment? I mean, I know there must be lots of moments, and your goal is to make it always real. But is there a moment or a few that you can point to and say, yeah, that's Sam. I did that right there. That's Sam.
Well, there's some obvious ones. 9/11 happened, and they were in the middle of putting together the two towers. And not even in the middle. They were sort of late in it. And they went and found text in the book that they thought spoke to the global emotional, you know, state of being, and they tried it in different characters, and they just, it didn't feel right. So then they gave it to Sam, and I remember sitting in our little house in Calabasas, California, and the fax machine rang. Now, for those of you who don't know what a fax machine is, it's a device depicted in early science fiction in the Arthur C. Clarke, I think, was the first to. But anyhow, so it came. That scene came through. It's like in the great tales, Mr. Frodo, the ones that really matter. Folk in those stories had lots of chances of turning back, only they didn't. There's some good left in this world, Mr. Frodo. It's worth fighting for. You're like, oh my gosh, that. You know, I was in my bathrobe when I read it, and I think I was jumping up and down, and my bathrobe was open. But I was so, it was like a touchdown at the Super Bowl, and my wife, who we've been married 24 years at that point, I guess it was, you know, like 15 years or something, and she, whatever it was, and she was used to me behaving strangely. But I just remember holding up the curly paper and like, look at this. And she read it, and we looked at each other, and you just thought, you know, anybody could read these words, and it's earth-shatteringly perfect. Mm-hmm. So the fact that I got to be the one to do it, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. felt like, well, I just acknowledged what a blessing it was, what a gift. It's a gift. Mm-hmm. So that's one. And you know, running Shagrat through with Sting was pretty great. You know, what does he say? Not if I stick you first, you know? Like, I felt like a hero. There were things about, like, we watched the Ralph Bakshi version. Oof. It's fun now. But I was terrified looking at it because I thought, oh my God, is this what Peter... Like, am I supposed to be a... Well, I don't know, Mr. Frodo. I mean, Tolkien writes it. They're always bursting into tears, left, right, and center, you know? And but to me, there's a nobility in it. But the way Ralph Bakshi did it, it was like... It was just buffoonery. So at one point, we were doing a fight sequence with the cave troll. And I wanted to fight. And I remember Peter came in, and this was... kind of a tour de force performance for Peter. He had all the stunt guys, stunt coordinators, and all the stunties, and for both the humans that were, you know, cast, and then the doubles, the scale doubles, and their double stunt people. I mean, it was a proscenium affair, and he came in and he acted out the entire cave troll fight sequence in Balin's tomb. And he was brilliant. He was great as the cave troll. You know, I thought he nailed Legolas. He said, and with every part that he would do, he would really change. I mean, but then he went to go shoot something else. And it was left up to us to work with the stunt guys. And we had the cameras there, and we were kind of like, we were unattended. And so, you know, I worked with the stunt guys, and they were happy that we were athletic and that we wanted to do it. And Sam opened up a serious can of whoop-ass, man. It was great. And I remember running in with a clamshell to watch Peter, and I'm like, what do you think? And he had this look like, you know, I'm happy that Sean feels that he got to, you know, it's fun to watch somebody have fun, and maybe there's a little something more there than I would have originally, you know, I would have had Sam in the comedy box. So, like, in those kind of moments, I felt like I was a pretty good steward for the kind of what Sam was supposed to be, with his feet firm in the ground and strong. So.
And now, judging by the enormous number of people here, I'm positive there are people who have questions. So come and please line up at the microphone in front. And when it gets to you, be sure to speak right into that microphone, because you won't be heard otherwise. And come ask some questions for our guys.
Can I please give you the picture?
No, that's great.
Oh.
Yeah. Come on all the way around here and come up the stairs. Oh, look at that.
Oh, wow.
Isn't that sweet? But it's to Sam from Charlotte, age 5, and it's Sam and Frodo, but then her shirt says Barrel Rider. So pleasure that. Thank you.
She did have a question for you, if it's okay.
Okay, yeah.
Ask quickly. Ask him your question.
Was it scary to work with? Can you tell me in the microphone? Yeah.
Was it scary to work in the movie?
With Gollum.
With Gollum.
She wants to know if Gollum was scary.
He was a rat.
He was a stinker and a villain, but I was never scared of him.
Hi, I'm just wondering for both of you, what was, like, you can choose, like, the best part or the most annoying part about the movies you were in?
The best part was the barrels. That was like a fairground ride. We did this part of it in the Pelorus River, which is in the north of the South Island. In typical, I'm sure this resonates with you, Sean, typical Peter Jackson fashion, we fully expected our stunt doubles to be doing the actual pulling themselves down the river. And he led us to this promontory overlooking the river and said, you can bring around the stuntie. And the stunt guy comes around the corner paddling in a barrel wearing a wetsuit and a crash helmet, right? And we're like, okay, and he executes a perfect sort of scuba exit into the water, climbs up on the beach, boom. And we're like, very impressive, Peter, that's fantastic. And he says, shall we shoot it? And with that, we are led like lambs to the proverbial slaughter down to this little area that they'd concealed from us. And we were just put into barrels, in Stephen Hunter's case, quite literally like a cork. I mean, he was rammed into it. They pulled away the safety rope, and we were on our own. And he just rolled the cameras, and we did that over and over again. Richard Armitage nearly drowned. William Kircher and John Callum breached the safety rope, and they were floating down towards the ocean and had to be rescued. So there was all that. But despite that, all of that sequence was my favorite. The worst was probably, there's a few uncomfortable moments, but having 400 pounds of fish poured on my head in a barrel was pretty, yeah, it was just disgusting.
I can imagine.
It just stank. We all stank. Everything stank. The soundstage stank for days. Everything. I mean, I can still almost smell it now. It was bad. So that was a low point.
Want to go for sushi?
For me.
Well, the high point, I was trying to explain to somebody at the table today when they ask what your favorite movie is that you've done, that I give a different answer every time because you can't choose, really. Every movie means something different to you. But a lot of times, the way I think about movies, I'm not thinking about how it turned out or the experience of the movie when you're watching it. I'm thinking, my child was born when we were filming that, you know, or my, you know, I was the first time I was old enough to drive myself to the set. You know what I mean? Like those kind of things are like the first things that pop into my head. So with that, you know, my wife of 24 years, Christine, and our daughter, Allie, who just started college. Raise your hand if that made you feel older. Welcome to my world. So she was 2 when she went down there and 5 when we finished and 7 by the time the third one premiered. Having them there the whole time, every day, they could come down to the set if they wanted to every day. They were welcome to. They ended up, you know, Allie went to school with Peter's kids and they got up to their own kinds of things. But I felt like a man. I felt like a man who was giving an experience to his family that was unique, that was extraordinary, that was life-changing and totally memorable. So whenever I was going through my uncomfortable times and they would come down, I just felt like I was doing something important. Important for that, and then also the ideas of what were in Tolkien's mind and heart when he wrote the books, that you looked around and you knew this was, you know, likely going to be the most substantial, you know, meaningful, impactful, important work I would do in my entire life. So you wanted to own it. The hardest part was I had to be fat for 2 years. And that, you know, I'm a runner. I'm doing the Ironman in Kona triathlon in 21 days. So, yeah, I expect you all to be paying close attention to that. Thank you very much. I did the 14K run, the Huda Pool today. Did you know that Cincinnati is hilly? It's very hilly here. But, like, I couldn't run. At one point, I decided Jeremy Woodhead, my makeup artist, we all had different makeup artists over the 2 years, but Jeremy and I got on great, and at a certain point, we went to the tennis club, and we played tennis. Now, I'm fat, and I wasn't very good at it, so he would, you know, it was terrible. But one day, somebody takes a picture, and this is really before paparazzi was kind of, you know, rote or blasé or typical. You know, it was like... So somebody took a picture of me, and on the cover of the national newspaper in Wellington, there I was in my fitness kit. And when I came to work, Peter, who has this sort of lounge chair sitting behind the monitors, had the newspaper. And he was just kind of looking at it. And I came in, and he said, more lollies for Mr. Astin, please.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to try not to answer so long. Sorry.
My question, it kind of ranges throughout both of your careers. Other than playing these amazing characters, bringing these stories to life in acting, you've both have done voice acting as well. Playing two of one of my absolute favorite characters, Raphael and Loki. Right into the mic, sorry. What's harder, acting, or what's more difficult, acting or voice acting?
I would say, they just make different demands on you, I suppose. Depending what kind of voice acting you're doing. For instance, you know, if you're doing an animated show, you might be in a group, like doing a table read, and you all do your roles at the same time, and they're great fun, you know. But obviously you're not running around the room in the same way, and with motion capture on video games, you know, that's more of a kind of combination of theater and film for me. And they're all, at the end of the day, I think all of them have more in common than they have, differences. And it always comes down to trying to tell the truth in whatever you're doing in any situation. You know, whether that's playing Loki or whether it's Dwalin or Dougal McKenzie or whatever it is, you bring that, hopefully you bring that truth to the scene. And in that sense, they're exactly the same. So, yeah.
Awesome.
And there's a in the voiceover industry, the working class, you know, hard scrabble business of doing voiceover acting, the kind of rank and file voiceover actors, always get the question, oh, do you do any real acting?
Yeah.
And it is just an awful thing. It's harder to go through makeup, get your costume on, go to the set. It takes longer. When we're filming in front of a camera, if there's stunt sequences, you know, in Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, I go, ooh, on a movie set, you'd be rolling around and jumping and somebody could accidentally hit you. And like, but the performance thing, the truth thing is exactly it. It's about wanting to honor whatever the essence of that character and story is, and what, you know, ultimately we're professionals. We're there to deliver a performance for the people who are paying us, and the artists that the filmmakers, and the in the case of animation, there's like 150 people who are all involved with really making the story. We're just like the icing on top. So, but our job is to try and be completely true to ourselves, and yet at the same time give them what they want and need. So I agree completely, is the same.
Awesome. Thank you.
better tap those question lines, because I hate I hate at the end when you say like you're done and 10 people who've been standing up have to leave. So sometimes we'll do a lightning round. But okay.
So my question is, which set was your favorite one to actually be on? Like, not what was shot on it, but what was your actual favorite set?
Gosh, that is very difficult. A lot of us, me included, really loved Bayonne's house. It was so beautiful. The carving, the wood carving they did. There were things on that set that the camera just passed over and they were lost in milliseconds that people had spent weeks creating. There was one in particular. I know Richard had Bayonne's chair. He had one made for him, the actual right size rather than too big. And there was a chessboard and chess pieces, Bayonne's chessboard. It was just beautiful. So that really was very memorable as a work of art. I mean, there were some amazing sets and everything, but that was pretty special, yeah.
Well, you say sets. I mean, I think of, you know, like there's construction that goes into a set. The location of filming on Mount Ropehu, the active volcano, or filming on the other mountains, I can't remember the names of them, at the top of the South Island, or down in the Remarkables in the bottom of the South Island. Like those locations were incredible. The actual sets themselves, the Elvin, you know, Rivendell, and the way they built those sets outside months before even pre-production started, and then would allow the you know, natural environment to grow around it. So you had this sense when you got there that it was real, that it had really been there. You were really discovering kind of ruins or something. It was, so that is one of 100 answers we could give you.
Thank you.
Of course.
I was wondering what your favorite costume that you've seen today is.
Oh.
No pressure.
I saw a 4'6" Stay Puft Marshmallow Man that I thought was pretty great.
Really?
Yeah. It was great. I don't know how he must have, it didn't seem to have like a fan in it or something, but it was puffed up and I remarked, look, it's a Stay Puft Marshmallow Man.
Well, I didn't see, I saw it yesterday actually, but a gentleman wore my costume from Outlander. He was dressed as Dougal McKenzie, and it was a remarkable piece of work. I mean, it was like he'd stolen it from my trailer. He looked fantastic. So yeah, he stands out for me, and you're good.
I bet if you would have told security,
yeah,
you would have won the who's got more credibility thing. You could have got that costume.
I was also wondering, what's the funniest thing that happened on set?
Oh, wow.
Superlatives are hard. What's something funny that happened on set is easy to answer. What's the funniest thing? I go into some sort of like nervous breakdown trying to think how to answer. The boys would do practical jokes on each other, including flaming bags of dung outside each other's rooms, you know. You just hear somebody screaming and other people laughing, and you're like, I'm just going to keep my door locked for a while.
You know, Ian was particularly naughty in terms of adjusting the dialogue when the camera wasn't on him. So we were constantly being given lines, well, like, instead of, if I say that Bilbo Baggins is a burglar he is, he would change it to, if I say that Dildo Diggins is a burglar, then a burglar he is. And the camera was on us, and we had to try and react to this as in character. That was pretty difficult.
Come to think of it, Ian is the one who turned us all on to the fan fiction.
Well, there you go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I have three questions.
Well.
First one's for you. The other two are for you.
Okay.
I understand that you also played a different role in Rudy as Rudy, I think.
The movie Rudy. I played the title character Rudy. There were no additional Rudys hanging around at that time.
Which one did you like better, playing in The Hobbit or Rudy?
Well, I'm going to say Rudy because I wasn't in The Hobbit. If he asked Lord of the Rings, I would have to answer a different question.
And the other one, I know you're a dwarf, but I can't remember which one you are.
I'm the bald one. Yeah. Yeah, Dwalin. Yeah, the bald one. The only bald one. But yeah. And what was your other one? What was your other question?
Oh, I forgot my last one.
Don't worry.
You're good.
I like those glasses. You're a very smart young man, and I appreciate your question. Thank you very much for coming up to the microphone.
Thank you.
How did you feel if you messed up in Rudy, that if someone could like take a video of it and post it on YouTube, that you'd have a bunch of angry Notre Dame fans chasing you around?
I think I lived in abject terror, except that the internet hadn't been invented yet. But the Notre Dame fans, it's the same feeling as playing Samwise. I was too dumb to know how important it was to so many people. So I just did what I thought was right. And afterwards, when I realized the effect it was having, I was very grateful that I worked with people who knew how to give me good direction and protect me from bad decisions or things that would have 50,000 screaming Irish fans coming at me with a... yeah, so it's actually a more sophisticated question than I thought was going to happen, so thank you for that.
Were you actually running in the last football game?
Was I actually running in the last football game? Well, it was only 27 seconds, so no matter what it wasn't a lot of running, but... my character, yes. Basically, the way we filmed the final sequence in Rudy was, it was during the Boston College Notre Dame football game, sold out, and we had Georgia Tech was the team that was being depicted as the opponents in the movie from the early 70s. So the microphones all went out, and the crowd didn't know what was happening. But the band, who gets 15 minutes at halftime to do their routine, was good enough to cut their routine in half and give us 7.5 minutes. So we had a very carefully choreographed routine of plays that could be used. And then we would film parts of the movie other times and they would interact together. But we had to get some of it where you could see all the people. So you only had one chance to do it. And when the actual game with Boston College and Notre Dame came off for halftime, normally, people would go to the bathroom, go and buy more beer, you know, I don't know, whatever people do at halftime. We came on this sort of spectral 1970s era, not sure what's happening, come running onto the field. Nobody left. Nobody sat down. They were all staring at, you know. We all assumed our natural positions, and I got to come in and run, and I did it by myself. I was me. I got to be me and line up on the defense line and look over. My wife was sitting there on the sideline, and I gave her a look, and she looked at me, and then I looked back. Now, we knew what was going to happen because we had choreographed it, but there still was this feeling in the moment, like, what's going to happen? And if they hike the ball and the guy drops it, do we know to, like, stop and go back to the beginning? This was like a Broadway play all of a sudden. He hikes the ball. I go running around. Every step I get closer to the guy, the crowd starts screaming. They were into it. They knew which team to root for. They understood the basic premise of the game. And then when I sacked the quarterback, they went crazy. And yeah, so thanks for that.
We are going to have time for about two more.
No. You can't do that. Speed round. Just go through, ask your question. You're not going to get the answer right away. We'll answer as much as we can remember when we get there. You can't have people standing for a long time and then not get to ask a question.
Okay, I just wanted to know, because in Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit, there's a lot of really close relationships between the characters. Are you guys still close with the other actors that you were in the movies with?
Yes, next.
Yes.
When you are on set and acting, how do you decipher your fantasy and the character from the
from
yourself? Normal world around you, like the reality around you with people watching you?
The same way a child does.
Yeah. Just imagination. That's all, really. That's it.
What was perhaps the toughest scene for you guys to film in your careers?
I would refer to my previous answer.
I'm sorry.
No. The fish was... That was a challenge, I've got to be honest. All day having fish poured on your head was interesting.
The football scene in Rudy. No.
Sean, what was one of your favorite scenes to film in The Goonies?
Kissing the girl.
As somebody who kind of grew up with Sean's roles in Mikey and Rudy and Sam, how much of yourself really goes into the character? Like, how do you bring that kind of courage and that determination to four?
I think nowadays the movies are so sophisticated and the audience is so sophisticated that it's really hard to, unless it's a very stylized movie where you're doing satirical stuff or something like that, they cast people who kind of are what they're supposed to be. So I just try and be as true to myself and the character, and a lot of times they happen to overlap. So I'm very grateful that I've been able to do that.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Have you ever wanted to be in a Marvel movie?
Yes.
Yes.
In the Lord of the Rings and the Hobbit, what was the prank you hated the most that was pulled?
The what?
Prank,
sorry?
You hated the prank you hated the most.
The prank.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Oh, Billy Boyd and Dominic Monaghan had a thing where they could read each other's minds. And they had for 3 or 4 days. I was going mad. I mean, it was not funny anymore, and I was angry at them and trying to get them to tell me how they did this thing. And they're like, "It's not doing. We're reading each other's minds. Like, you think of something. I'm gonna point. You tell them what it is. I'm gonna point to it. And when I point to the thing that is actually what you're thinking, you say yes. And they would go through it. And yeah, I couldn't figure. The math didn't work. Like, I didn't get. And Billy finally took pity on me and let me in on the thing.
Well, I would say to this day, I suspect that the entire fish sequence was a prank. So that would be it.
I just want to quickly say thanks to both of you for helping bring to life something that was very important to me when I was a child. But my question is, was Christopher Lee as awesome as he seemed when you worked with him?
I got to fly to Los Angeles with him from Auckland, sitting next to each other.
Oh, wow.
The depth and breadth of his knowledge and his life experience. I'm a talker. Except on that flight. So I'm sad that he lived a great life, a long life, but it is a sad passing.
Thank you. And Dwalin is definitely the best dwarf, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
I was just assuming you didn't work with
him. No, it's fine.
I know that the Fellowship did the tattoos thing where they all got the nine. Did the dwarves do the same thing?
No, we didn't do the tattoo thing. We did the ring thing. So this is this bronze ring that's in the middle of my finger there has on the inside, because the dwarves hide their treasure. It's the entire journey of the dwarves in the movie that the guy who made the one ring made for us, and so all the dwarves have those. Yeah.
You married the dwarves?
Yes. We are now married.
And then real quick, when you listen to the commentaries, especially in The Lord of the Rings, all the actors are like, I don't remember doing that scene.
I feel that about everything. Honestly, I'm going to be over there. Somebody's going to come up in line and say, "Well, that was really great what you said." And I'll be like, what did I say? I don't even remember.
My question's primarily for Sean. How do you like your potatoes?
Boiled, mashed, stick them in a stew.
All right, thank you guys so much for coming out. Between the two of you guys, I know Peter filmed a lot of separate sequences, like a year apart. Like, I know some Return of the King, then back to Fellowship. How hard was it to go back to those scenes that you had filmed a year ago?
It wasn't actually that difficult, personally. I mean, I found you could just jump back into it, and we had the help of having it all to to hand, so he was able to show us what we'd been doing beforehand, so we didn't completely forget. But no, I didn't find it difficult. No.
The worst part was that you had spent a year getting more in touch with the character and getting better. And you'd show up to do the other side, and he was happy just to do the bit that he didn't have. And you'd want to start over and do the whole thing, and he wouldn't do it. So you're left thinking, you know, the first half of it is good, the second half is great, and, you know, so that was hard.
How you doing?
Hey.
I'll lift it up. Yep. That's it.
How emotional was that scene when in Return of the King when Frodo was leaving Middle Earth?
Pretty emotional. It was very, you know, this idea of what, you know, what are the gray havens? You know, somebody asked me the other day, I said, Frodo lives, you know, it's like, so that was emotional. There, it was, which I think is what you want to know. It was bringing that up and saying goodbye is actually easy to get emotional as an actor because there's that sensation, we all know what that means to say goodbye, the nature of saying goodbye. I forgot to put my vest on, the one nice pretty vest that the elves gave me after the lunch. So it was, the continuity was wrong. So we had to go and reshoot it. I maintain that no one would know the difference, but so that was hard.
And my condolences to Christopher Lee.
Yeah.
I just want to say that sitting here listening to you, you're a fantastic storyteller, and you have such amazing tales. I want to know, like, are you planning on writing a book about all these little stories and things that happened during filming the movie? Or
I did one.
You did?
Right after. It's called There and Back Again, An Actor's Tale.
I'm going to go get it. I need
and,
that.
I didn't put nearly enough of the cool kinds of stuff we're talking about here. It's an oral history, really, I feel. Thank you for the good compliment.
Who wins in a foot race, the Fellowship or Thorne's Company?
In a foot race?
In a foot race.
Oh, I think the Fellowship would win, to be honest. I mean, we were carrying 70 pounds on our backs running, so I think we would probably, wearing size 18 boots. We would run, we would sprint, we would be running our hearts out, and Peter would say, yeah, that was great. Can you go faster? So they would win.
What distance were you thinking? I'm a runner, so I'm curious. Are we a marathon or a 100-yard dash?
Originally, I was thinking marathon. Then I thought fun run, but I'm not sure what the distance.
Anything longer than a 100-yard dash, Fellowship for sure, because dwarves are only deadly or only quick over short distances.
Should have known it.
I've been watching your movies since I was like 3 years old. Sorry. And they've impacted my life so much. And I was wondering, sorry.
She's so cute. You can't see it because her back is to you, but I'm looking at such a pretty face right now. Go ahead, what are you thinking?
I'm so sorry.
All right, you step back. He'll ask you a question, then you get the last question. Compose yourself, young lady. You're so sweet.
Hi, I'm just wondering, what's your most memorable moment on the set with Ian McKellen, and what's it going to take to get McKellen to come do a Comic-Con, because I've been wanting to meet this guy for years.
Yeah, well, I don't know whether he'll do one, but there were so many, he was absolutely fantastic. To be honest with you, my favorite moments with Ian were, you know, pranking aside and all the rest of it, was watching him work, you know, as an actor. And it was a great privilege to be in some of the scenes that he was in and see a master at work. And we all felt that when we would sit around at Bag End, etc. And yeah, I mean, he was very funny, but very professional and very, very good at what he does. So yeah.
You know, our makeup bus was like a hollowed out 18-wheeler with four stations, makeup stations. Mm-hmm. It was a federal case to get all the ears and everything, wigs and everything. And then at the closest to the front, there was a door, a sliding door, and there was another, like a standalone chair, the sort of for the queen or whatever. I say that because, so he would be in his makeup bus, and Elijah Wood was the DJ. He would bring in every day these large binders of CDs, and he took great joy in sort of, you know, DJing the morning for everybody, starting at 4 in the morning. And I just always loved, at a certain point in the DJing, the door in between where we were and where Ian was would just slowly close. he's such a, I think to get him to come to an event, there would have to be something culturally specific and unique. The, you know, these conventions, the things that make them special is that it's you today, and it's you today, you know, and we're here together today. But the idea of it, there's thousands of these things. So I think he'd have to, somebody'd have to appeal to him on a level of like, this is why these people are getting together, like Woodstock or something, you know, and the, or a gay rights thing or something, something like that. You can get him. He's a clever, funny game guy. Like he'll go for certain stuff, but he just doesn't want to feel like he's just got a lot of choices of what he wants to do with his time, you know. And I would watch him and see how he'd make decisions from performance things to what he was going to do on the weekend, how he would talk about the plays he had done. And he's just cool from top to bottom. Yeah. Let's see if she can get through her question now.
As I was saying, your movies have impacted my life so incredibly. And I was wondering if you ever believed that you would make such an impact on the world. People in it.
Everybody makes a big impact on the world. Everybody. It's pretty visible when a movie comes out and it literally makes $3 or $4 billion, and you know that people all over the world have seen it in 100 languages, and you know. But I think in those moments, I don't think of it as me. I think of it as, you know, I'm a professional actor, second generation actor, and I learned something from my parents about what that means. I mean, this is if you look at plumbers or carpenters or whatever, the 10,000 years of tradition and craftsmanship and stuff goes into their work, and there's pride in it. And it's the same thing for acting. Acting is no less important than, I mean, maybe medicine and plumbing are more important, but, you know, once the person's healed and once they've got a house to live in, then what are they going to do? At a certain point, human emotions need to be processed and reflected so back, true. And that's what we do. So to me, I'm like, I'm just a vessel, man. I'm just a vessel. I'm there to try and deliver it, and if people are moved by it, you know, it's the music. Watch Rudy without the music. Not as good a movie. You know what I mean? Like, there's a million other things to focus on. And I love coming to these conventions because you can touch other people. And, like, physically, you shake hands, give you a hug. And it's very good ego boost. I go home and my wife and kids are like, yeah. You know, but here you get this feedback all day long for 2 days about how people have been moved. And that, it makes it real. So that's, it makes it tangible and specific, and you can hold it in the palm of your hand. So I never take that for granted. My father always taught me that every human interaction is sacred. So the hard thing is that you can't have interactions with everyone you wish you could have interactions with, because sometimes you have a mission. Sometimes you have your responsibility. Sometimes you just want to do something and you can't hug everyone physically. So I just hope that the goodness of the moments that happen, whether it's somebody watching a television show or a movie or something like that, or a personal interaction like this, I just hope that sends something good and positive out that can't be diminished in any way ever for any reason. So.
Thanks everybody so much for being here today. We need to give up the room quickly, so if we can exit to this side, that'll be great. Come and see these guys at their tables. Middle Earth forever.